Morning, everyone. Some of my colleagues, as you can see, are running a little bit late today. There's a lot going on here in the Capitol, as we're only here for one day this week, so everything's kind of getting crammed into one day. But I want to get started on time here. We've got the room booked for an hour. I assume we're going to go longer than that and have some good discussion. I know that my colleagues are going to be here at some point. But I do want to welcome you and everyone for their involvement in this growing hemp industry in New York. I think we're making great headway on this and look forward to seeing its further growth. I thank all of you that have been involved throughout this several year process now to get to where we are and want to learn more about what we need to do to get it going further. So with that, I will go around the table here, have everybody just briefly introduce yourselves, and then we have a presentation by Cornell Kales on what their progress has been, and then we'll open it up to general discussion. So you want to start?
Well, sure. Joy Beckerman. I'm the president of the Hemp Industries Association, founded in 1994, and principal expert witness and legal support provider at Hemp Ace International.
Mark Privatero, lately been known as the mad scientist of Ellisburg up in Jefferson County. And we grow hemp, we process hemp, among other things.
Good afternoon, I'm Chris Logue. I'm with the New York State Department of Agriculture and Markets, Division of Plant Industry, and we work with the hemp industry in a regulatory capacity.
Jeff Palmer, Director of Intergovernmental Affairs, New York State Department of Agriculture and Markets.
Jeff Williams, Director of Public Policy at New York Farm Bureau.
Henry. It's my turn. Mm-hmm. I'm Henry Vincenti from Indoca. We produce pharmaceuticals and food supplements in Europe, and we grow hemp and extract and do all the processing. We grow about 2,000 acres. So.
I'm Jen Gilbert Jenkins from Morrisville State College, and I'm involved in industrial hemp research there.
Julie Torres, Cornell College of Ag and Life Sciences.
I'm Larry Smart. I'm a professor of plant breeding at Cornell.
Chris Smart, professor of plant pathology at Cornell.
Well, thank you all for being here. I especially want to thank Cornell and Morrisville for your leadership in this industry over the years, and definitely Ag and Markets as well for also taking a very strong leadership role in helping get this set up and moving along to give us things that we need to change legislatively. And with that, we'll get into Cornell's presentation with Dr. Chris Smart.
Thank you, Senator.
There's a little switch on the bottom there.
Yep. Fortunately, they're the same around the world.
So good afternoon. My name is Christine Smart, and I have actually the honor of leading our hemp team at Cornell. The work we're going to present today is really the part of a team. I am the director of the School of Integrative Plant Science at Cornell, and we'll be discussing a bit about the work that we're doing. So the school is only 4 years old. For the 150 years prior to that, we were five separate plant science departments at Cornell. 4 years ago, we formed one school. The school brings together former departments of horticulture, plant biology, plant breeding and genetics, plant pathology and plant microbiology, that's where I am, and soil and crop science. And our hemp team is truly interdisciplinary, covering all sections from the most basic aspect of the secondary metabolites that hemp makes, all the way up through those of us who are working out in the field. We're breeding, we're working out in the field with growers to really put together an interdisciplinary team. We also have entomologists who are not part of our school, but are certainly part of our hemp team. Vision statement is discovery that connects, which we really focus on utilizing the basic discoveries in plant science and finding and using those to provide solutions, scientific-based solutions, in fact, to the problems affecting agriculture in New York State. We're very proud to be the land-grant university for the state, and we take that very seriously. So I thought I'd briefly cover some of the history of hemp. Many of you may know this. I do want to point out that hemp is not marijuana. It has very low THC. It's non-psychoactive. So the hemp that we work with will not give you a high. Although we're really excited about it. It was widely planted in the colonies in the 1700s. There's actually a really cute sign during the World War that said, you know, victory, hemp for victory. They wanted people to grow, plant and grow hemp. The hemp was used for fiber, and it was really an important part of the history here in North America. It boomed during World War II. By the mid-1950s, it was replaced by synthetic farmers, and hemp farming actually declined. It was banned in 1970 by the Controlled Substance Act. And then in 2014, the Farm Bureau, sorry, we do love the Farm Bureau, but the Farm Bill, too many things in my head, the Farm Bill allowed pilot research programs in hemp, and that is what has really enabled states across the country to get back into industrial hemp research and industrial hemp production. I do want to highlight that in 2016, there were 15 states that had industrial hemp programs for a total of just under 10,000 acres. And in 2017, 34 states, over 25,000 acres were planted across the country, and there's no sign of that slowing down. I'm certain that it will be much higher in 2018. So I don't know what you guys do on your holiday weekends. Memorial Day weekend is coming up. But what Chris and Larry Smart do on our holiday weekends is we drive around the state of New York and we find feral hemp. So we have a lot of fun in the Smart family. feral hemp is here. The reason I have it on the history of hemp cultivation is because we grew so much hemp that there is still feral hemp that it has been reseeding itself every year since the 1950s. And we are going to be able to use that feral hemp as part of our germplasm program to develop cultivars of hemp that are specifically suited for the conditions that we have here in New York State. So I thought I'd give you an idea of what some of these plants look like. There are many uses for hemp. I think Joy has told me that there's 25,000. I don't know if you can name all of those, Joy. But fiber production for rope and fabrics is one. Fiber production, this was our intern, Amelia. She's about my height, and the hemp was clearly taller than Amelia. We actually harvested it with a sickle bar. So fiber production hemp, you really want to have rapid growing tall plants so you can get the fibers out. I think Mark has some examples of those. Grain production, on the other hand, you're really looking, the grain is produced in these flower buds, and the flowers are all compacted together. There would be grain inside there, and you harvest it with a combine. So it's a very different type of a crop. And those flower buds, I should say the grain can be used roasted and eaten as seed. You can press it, as was, this was grain grown here in New York, pressed by a local Finger Lakes company into hemp seed oil. And so you can press that grain into oil. And the seed cakes, after you press it from oil, are very high in protein, and we're looking into if those can even be used for animal feed because it's so high in protein. Those flower buds that were at the top of those grain-producing plants, if you look at a close-up image of them, this is actually one flower, and the seed would be inside there. The seed is very small. We have some examples of it. It's 3 millimeters big. And on that seed, on the outsides of those seeds, you have what are called trichomes. They're hairs. Like if you think about a tomato leaf, that would be all hairy. Those are trichomes. Hemp has the same thing. And inside those trichomes is where the cannabidiols, or CBDs, are produced. And Henry talked about those for pharmaceuticals. And that is another way, another use of hemp, and people are actually planting specifically for the harvest of those products. So we really have a lot of different uses for hemp, and we need to find plants that are specifically targeted for each of those uses. Finally, we have some really entrepreneurial growers here in the state of New York, and we have several growers now that are producing hemp as baby greens. So what you get is a little tiny leaf that looks like a hemp leaf that you can sell to people. They'll put it in their salads. I found it, to be honest, to taste a bit like a leaf. Some people find it to be buttery, but there's a market, which is fantastic. So in terms of markets, the estimated 2016 market, $688 million. That's a big number. And again, we imagine that it's only going to increase from there. Wow, that's an interesting take on my on the slide. The largest category is this right, Larry? Yeah.
Personal care products
is the largest category here. Then there are food products, CBD-based products. Oh, right, industrial products. Things like hempcrete. You can make concrete, a very strong concrete, but it's much lighter by including hemp into that. And the last slide that I have before I turn it over to Larry is about some of the hemp-based personal care products. This is actually a photo we got from Julie Suarez. She was in a local store, and there was an entire display about hemp, and they were in no way making it, you know, they were definitely connecting it to hemp with the placement of the leaves. While it is a hemp leaf, it looks very similar to a marijuana leaf. And we do have several personal care products here as well that you guys can look at. There's lotions, there's chapsticks, body scrub. So but there's all sorts of things that have the hemp oil in it. And it's very much a growing market. There are many companies that are interested in tapping into this market. And so we're very enthusiastic and optimistic about the prospects for hemp in the state of New York.
Thanks, Chris. Again, my name is Larry Smart. I've been leading the plant breeding efforts at Cornell for industrial hemp. And as Chris just mentioned, there's about a $700 million market estimated in 2016 for hemp products, but essentially all of that product was imported into the U.S. So that's the attraction there, especially as we think about growing local, right? We want these food products, personal care products, food oil to be grown locally. So we know there's a market, but until the 2014 Farm Bill passed, we were not able to produce that locally. We have had fantastic leadership from the legislature and the governor and Ag and Markets in prudently scaling up the hemp industry in New York State. And as the land grant institution for New York, this is our vision for how we propose to help promote that hemp industry. First of all, we want to evaluate the available hemp cultivars that are out there to be able to tell growers what's going to produce the highest yield, what cultivars might have pest and disease problems, which are best to our soil types in New York State. We also are evaluating interest among growers and among processors and modeling the cost of production to make sure that they match market value so that financially it makes sense for growers to grow hemp. We know that there is a lot of interest based on license applications to Ag and Markets. So it's now our task, together with Cornell Cooperative Extension, to educate those growers and processors with science-based knowledge. One of the barriers to hemp production is acquiring seed. So it requires a DEA permit to import seed into the country, and it is still a gray area whether we can move seed across state lines. So we think it's an important early target to establish local certified seed production with the long-term goal of developing locally adapted cultivars for New York State through our breeding program. So I just want to give you some snapshots of our research funded by Empire State Development and New York State Ag and Markets from 2017 in our plant breeding program. evaluating hemp cultivars that are available commercially right now in small plot trials. So we had 17 different cultivars, some of those bred for grain production, some of them bred for fiber production, that we planted across six different sites, evaluating different growth parameters, pest and disease incidence, and yield and quality components. So I'm just going to show you some data from those and try to highlight sort of a take-home message from each of those data points. So these are the 17 cultivars that we tested, and maybe you can see, maybe not, some of them are bred in Europe, in France, the Ukraine, and Poland. There are breeding programs in Canada and others in Italy. There's also large breeding programs in China, which we have not tapped into yet. But again, maybe not a strong expectation that cultivars bred in Italy will perform well here in New York State. So that's why we need a local breeding program. Hemp grows very quickly, and there are no herbicides or pesticides labeled for use on hemp. But fortunately, if your seed is well established, it will close canopy very quickly and shade out weeds. So you can see that after 3 weeks. After 7 weeks, the plants are 6 to 7 feet tall here in our grain trial. And Chris already showed this, but in the fiber trial, 8 to 9 feet tall at the time of harvest. So one of the questions is, again, can we produce yields of hemp that are economically viable for farmers? And what are the appropriate planting times, soil types, fertilizer rates? And we did fiber trials on sites in Ithaca and Geneva. One thing we learned is that that late planting date of June 28th was not ideal for fiber growth. We really want to be planting probably a month before that, at least. We did hit the appropriate planting window in the Ithaca trial and achieved yields of 4 to 5 dry tons per acre, which is economically viable. So with only one season of yield data, I'm going to go out on a limb and say we can produce economically viable yields of fiber hemp. On the grain side, again, we're evaluating different commercially available cultivars so we can advise growers as to yield and also to assess, again, are we in a range that's economically viable? This was across all 5 sites, including the poor quality sites. We got an average yield of 1,400 pounds of grain per acre, with a high yield on the best site of 2,400 pounds per acre. And the average yield for Canadian hemp growers is about 800 to 1,000 pounds per acre. So if we can produce consistently 2,000 pounds per acre or more of grain, again, this will be an economically viable crop. I would just want to highlight some of the features of that grain that you can see when you read the nutritional information on these hemp heart products or the protein extract. Hemp grain is very high in protein here, the highest one, 27% protein. So this is non-soy, gluten-free, GMO-free, best grown organically. So it's ticking off many of those labels that consumers are looking for now. We want it to be locally grown as well. But it also produces a high amount of oil, as Chris highlighted here, that can be pressed for a very tasty salad or pesto oil, 35% oil with a very healthy blend of omega-6 and omega-3. The red bar is the omega-6 in a 3-to-1 ratio to the green bar, the omega-3s. So, you know, equivalent or better than fish oil in that aspect. Many of our growers in 2018 will be growing for cannabidiol, for CBD, to produce products as wellness and health supplements. So we evaluated the cannabidiol content of those different varieties. And again, we can identify some that may be useful for a dual cropping strategy, harvesting for both CBD and grain, or for CBD and fiber. And we always need to be concerned about the regulatory limits of THC. All of these cultivars need to stay below the legal limit of 0.3% THC. So all of our fields will be, well, regulated by Ag and Markets and tested appropriately. So we did that testing as well. And what we do see is there is environmental influence on THC levels. What we can say is some of those cultivars flirt with that 0.3 regulatory limit. So another goal of our breeding program is to breed for cultivars that have a stable, low level of THC, no matter where they're grown. So for 2018 and beyond, we will continue to evaluate commercial cultivars, and some of those are being produced in the U.S. now, breeding program in Colorado, and additional cultivars from Europe that are being imported into the U.S. So this year, our small plot variety trials will have 30 entries, up from 17 last year. We are working with companies to produce certified seed here in 2018 in New York so that they will be able to sell certified seed in 2019. And we have been building a germplasm collection and establishing crossing methods to be able to ultimately release cultivars adapted to New York State conditions. We'll be able to do two cycles of breeding each year, one in the greenhouse in the wintertime. So we just completed our first cycle of crossing plants in the greenhouse, and those seeds will be planted out for a cycle of field selection here for the summertime. So again, we couldn't do this without the support of the governor, legislature, and New York State Ag and Markets. We have made a big splash nationwide with the support that we get from the New York State government. Last week, I was in Kentucky talking with the lead researcher at the University of Kentucky, who's received a grand total in their 5 or 6 years of research of $12,000 from the state of Kentucky. So the nearly $4 million that the state has committed to research at Cornell and Mooresville State College has made a big impression nationwide and is attracting investors into New York State. So I'll stop there. Handing the microphone.
You can keep it because there might be at least okay. Initially here for. I've got my own, so we're good. And thanks for that plug on the investment that New York is making and the governor, his administration, the legislature. So thank you for your work and your leadership in this. What are you finding in your weekend excursions of feral hemp? That are those are you finding stock that are cultivars that are going to be able to be reproduced and do better here in our climate?
Yeah. So it's really interesting that we really have not found very many feral hemp populations. We found one last year, and now I've heard anecdotally of some up in the North Country. And one of the breeders in Ontario has been able to collect feral hemp around the lakeshore of Lake Ontario. But this all pales in comparison to the feral hemp that's still growing, which they call ditchweed, in Nebraska, Iowa, Minnesota, Indiana, Wisconsin. It's very common in the Midwest because that was the main region where all of this was grown for the war effort in the 1940s. Our hemp in New York State and in Ontario may actually still be a remnant from colonial days.
Hmm. Wow. Sturdy plant.
Let's hope so.
Yeah, exactly. Where are we on what I refer to as the chicken or the egg scenario on production versus processing? Because obviously if we have a good climate for it and we're able to grow it well, our farmers aren't going to grow it unless they have a market to sell it to. Where are we in that connection of markets for the hemp plants? And I'll open it up to anybody.
It is difficult to get farmers. I don't realize I need a microphone. Can you hear me in the back, everybody? Okay, thank you. Just in case you need
over there. It's true, putting one foot in front of the other here, that we're asking farmers to grow biomass for which there is very little infrastructure, and we're asking entrepreneurs to invest in an infrastructure for which there is only growing biomass. I will say that of the 25,000 plus acres that were grown in the United States last year, even though there were 34 states that have passed some form of legislation, it was only 18 states that created that 25 plus thousand acres. There were 19 reported, but Hawaii had a 0 acre. And we're already almost doubling license, at least permitted acres for the state of New York as we did last year. And there are some states that are exponentially increasing. I mean, it's gone up 700 times. Yet what we're seeing here is that there is so much interest in the plant that we are putting one foot in front of the other. There are investment dollars coming in. I do want to just state, again, copying what Larry has said here, New York has become the hempire state. It is the only state that has given, it truly is. I had a hemp store here back in the 90s, and I was calling it the hempire state then, and folks thought I was crazy, but who's crazy now, Andrew Cuomo and Senator O'Mara and Assemblywoman Lopardo? And that money that has come in has actually sparked interest all around. The big splash that that Professor Smart is talking about here has made some major ripples. We're the only state that has put a penny in grant funds, and we put $10 million in grant funds here. So that interest and the fact that we are necessity being the mother of invention, even petroleum companies and gas companies and plastic companies recognize that they are dealing with, and paper companies, that they're dealing with finite resources, that we need to come up with alternatives. And so that money is coming in, and New York and the tremendous job that our researchers are doing and that the Department of Ag is doing is really helping to increase that.
So the reality is that you need tens of millions of dollars to create processing plants that then can scale, so we can actually create an industry that has a demand that brings a lot of high volume people in. I'm a chemical engineer. I'm creating products from hemp that are a little different than the CBD and whatnot. And my vision is to, I want 100,000 acres at some point, right? But I can't get the investment capital because of the banking laws and the uncertainty in the legal status on the federal level keeps some investors having to stay on the sidelines because of legal due diligence and clauses in various investment contracts and whatnot. The state has been fantastic. Chris, awesome. I'm nominating him for whatever award you guys give the state guys for an award. It's been a fantastic program, and Larry and Jen and everybody. But if we want to make this soybeans, corn, and alfalfa, which is what we need to do, is make it one of those crops, we need hundreds of millions of dollars, and we need to set the framework so we can do that.
I would just add to that, I'm one of those people that joy, I can make it so you can hear me. I think that what we're seeing is the processing for the small scale coming in very quickly. So things like that small seed processing company that's making that oil, we're seeing a lot of local small production happening. A lot. I'm working with 8 different farms across the state this year, and 4 of them are doing their own processing. And so I think that we're seeing processing on the small scale. If we want to see the economics of this expand, that large scale processing is, that's where the chicken before the egg really becomes complicated.
Because we didn't need a change in federal law to allow it to move from research to true commercialization.
Yes.
That's right.
What is the status of Senator McConnell's effort to fully open this market up?
That's 2667. Already introduced it. He's trying to attach it to the farm bill. Senate version of the farm bill.
It has actually been Rule 14, which is an unusual process that takes place. So Senator McConnell and even now Chuck Schumer, the Senate Minority Leader, has also signed on, is using his power to skip the committee process entirely. That's the first time that this bill, which has been refiled in the Senate since 2013, is using the Rule 14 process
to skip committee and go straight to the Senate floor. On top of it, as sort of a double down chess move, Senator McConnell is also working that language into the Senate version of the Agricultural Act of 2018, which we call the Farm Bill. So it's a two-part process here, and the House has also filed a sister bill, HR 5485, identical in every word to Senate Bill 2667. So we have a lot of hope that we may actually be able to pass that this particular bill. The House version has been refiled every year since 2005 and it has gone nowhere.
You're impressive the way you remember these bill numbers, because I don't remember the bill numbers to my own bills. So, Chris or Jeff, where are we statewide on acreage now and this year, and what's our plan for future growth? But before I get into that, we've been joined by Assemblywoman Donna Lopardo. Thank you, Donna, for coming. Going well?
Yes.
Missed a good presentation by Cornell, but I'm sure you've seen most of it before.
I've seen many times.
So thanks for joining us.
And thanks for being here and provide a briefing on the things we have in the hopper and we're trying to get out front. So what have I missed?
Nothing. We were just talking about the chicken and the egg scenario with growth versus processing, and some discussion on that. And I was just getting to Chris and Jeff on where we are acreage-wise in the state.
So we're up over permit holder-wise, we're up over 100, I think, at this point, 106, 108, somewhere along through there. And permitted acreage for 2018 is at a little bit over 3,000. We're still chasing a few folks down to get them to commit. And you know, depending upon seed availability and weather and all of the variables within all agricultural crops, hopefully we'll be up over 3,000 this year.
Are we getting seed from what's being grown here in New York?
At this point,
is that not legal?
Well, it can move within New York State. We would allow that. We're working on a seed certification regulation so that we can ensure that seed is of the quality and the standards that farmers should be looking for. And so that's in the hopper for the next couple of months here to get that done. We have had seed imports from Canada and from the European Union that have come to our location in Albany. And we've had three, and one of them has been trouble-free. Two of them have not been trouble-free. And I will just leave it at, when you get an extra box that you weren't anticipating, that's a big deal for the DEA. And it's a big deal for us. So it's actually still sitting there. And we inventory it on a daily basis.
Yep.
Just wanted to point out to the folks that were here, in terms of the acreage issue, if this wasn't stated already, that New York, as of last year's crop, was the number five grower in the country and the number one grower in the Northeast. So we're definitely in the lead, no question around it. And we're also in the lead in terms of the general cooperation among all parties, whether it's the legislative branch, executive, and the agencies. It's really a remarkable collaboration, as I'm sure many of you can attest. Other states have not enjoyed that type
of... One of the stats you missed just before you walked in was that we've invested millions here through New York State, and Kentucky is, how much did they invest? 12,000?
12,000.
$12,000. So we're certainly leading the way on that. And, do you have any...
Apologies, folks, for being late. Do you want to come up?
If you'd like to.
John?
Senator Flanagan, do you want to come up? We've been joined by our Senate Republican leader, John Flanagan. Mm-hmm. Thanks, John, for showing up.
He's an expert on all things hemp.
No. On that note, it's been lovely to see all of you.
No, I apologize for missing the opening. I had two major things I had to do at the same time, but we've been down this stretch together for a few years now. And I really can't thank Senator Omar enough for his willingness to go down this road with me and with all of you. When we decided to take full advantage of the Farm Bill, This is exactly what we had in mind, but much more so given the governor's commitment and interest in this. Really accelerated the amount of investment that we're putting in, which we're seeing in the type of acreage and the level of processing and manufacturers, especially those manufacturers who are already dependent on imported seed and imported fiber and imported goods. So we're doing those local manufacturers a favor, and we're also creating huge opportunities for land and farmers, manufacturers, processors, and the like. The what we try to do, and we've got a bill now that we're trying to get out, we're trying to get out in front of issues that are now confronting us, and I'd be happy to talk about that after we're done hearing from everybody about some of the little tweaks that we need to make.
Sure. All of you are so remarkably well behaved. What is going on here? We got to get some caffeine in this room. You know, it's funny. All three of us have served here for quite a while, and I don't get over to this room this much. But for those who remember what it used to look like, this is much, much, much better than it was, and it's a great, convenient meeting room.
It's hemp green.
There you go. So. But I'm loving seeing all the names and all the background and the expertise. I just came by to quickly pay my respects. We have, goodness knows, we have a busy day here, as you can well imagine. But I guess what I would say is, first of all, thank you for people who have expertise. And I think one of our fundamental roles is we're supposed to listen. Because I remember going and seeing a lot of work done by Cornell. I think I've met some of you out in the field, and I learned a heck of a lot of things that I didn't know, but all valuable. And what strikes me perhaps more than anything else, in this type of area, and particularly in agriculture, the money that we invest, the return is so exponentially great and so much greater than so many other areas that we do in the state of New York that we're frankly missing opportunities. You know, a dollar invested yields a very significant return. So. I think I should probably just be respectful and say that.
So if you want somebody to kind of stir the pot, I'll stir the pot. People who know me know that. So what is the vehicle you guys have to affect the federal needed change? I mean, you guys have clout. Cuomo has clout. Is there, I don't know, is there a congressional or U.S. Senate reps here? Because that's really where I see we could use some help. The state's been fantastic. I'll tell you, I love this program. But the feds are, you know, what can we do?
I certainly have a lot of interaction with my own congressman, Tom Reed, who's very supportive of this, and others who I'm familiar with and see occasionally throughout the state. I think when you have, when you deal with something like hemp or marijuana, you don't typically have conservative Republicans jumping on board with these types of things. But I think with the hemp area, where you see somebody like me and Senator Mitch McConnell at the federal level being champions of this, I don't see it as a partisan issue at all. And it's something that should move. What the hang up is federally, I don't know for sure, but they have a lot of factions within their majorities that they have. Sometimes it's easier when you have a majority of one, because we don't have a choice of having factions. We're either all together or we're not. So having those factions sometimes makes it more difficult in the process, I think. But seeing McConnell and now, as you said, Schumer signing on to that, I mean, that's encouraging to me to really blow this wide open.
And may I just add that Senator Gillibrand co-sponsored last year's act, and I was at her office lobbying 2 weeks ago and thanked her in advance for co-sponsoring this act. I haven't seen any New York representatives, congressmen or women, thus far. And just as an action call, grassroots activism is very much a part of what I do. Hempsupporter.com, you can go to the resources tab there to very easily and quickly send letters to our New York federal senators and congresspeople to ask them to support. That doesn't get to your question. You're asking these guys, what can we do? But I just want to make sure folks.
If our vision is to grow this large, which would be great, right? That's what, or keep it niche. We got to decide. If it's going to be large, we're going to make it an industrial agricultural crop. We need to have coordinated efforts so that investment is enabled, development is enabled. If I'm going to throw down money for a large processing plant, it can't be in an uncertain environment such that federally something changes to where that investment is no longer viable. So that's all I'm saying. So I love the state program, but we've got to get more certainty in the overall picture.
We do. I just had my first call last week from a constituent who has some kind of a health food store or something like that, and she was just notified by her lender that they're going to call her loans because she's selling CBD,
hemp
oil. And that's the first I've heard of anybody in my district that's had that problem.
That's
so, I does anybody have any knowledge of that here as far as where we stand? You guys at Agri Markets know? Donna knows.
Let me just answer his question, and that's one of the things I was going to talk about, the bill that we just introduced. I don't know if the Senate can do this, but the Assembly is passing a resolution. It's working its way through committee, calling upon Congress to pass the Industrial Hemp Farming Act, and a copy will go to each member, imploring them to get on the bill. There were New Yorkers on the last version, so we got to get them back on. We've been tracking the farm bill's developments, and each year it seemed that the Kentucky representatives buried in another piece that truly, I think, was intended to benefit Kentucky farmers. Mm-hmm. My view, and Senator Mara knows this as well, is that I think they were trying to get Kentucky, you know, to finally have the complete advantage over all of us for when they finally legalized it, they would own the market. But because we were tracking every step along the way and exceeding them, you know, that is no longer at play. I think Joy probably knows this better than anybody, that there seems to be an argument between the federal government versus the federal government factions within the government that really haven't bought into this. And they have it all confused in their minds with legalizing marijuana writ large and medical marijuana, and they just haven't been able to come to terms. One of the problems we're finding right now, not only Watertown and in Brooklyn recently, CBD supplies are being confiscated. One person was in fact arrested because she was selling a CBD item. We have a bill that's going to define in public health law what marijuana and concentrated cannabis is. And what it is it has THC, a THC level of 3.3, greater than 0.3, to make it clear that if these items have that in it, then it would be illegal. But now I've found out that there's some dispute over whether or not we're able to sell products from other states. Even though we're importing plants from other states, using oil from other states, there's some disagreement with whether the laws we've passed covers out-of-state CBD products. So we may have to do another bill to make that clear. Just so you know, only 4 states in the country allow CBD products. It's 4. Washington, Kentucky, Colorado, and New York State.
Washington does not allow for extraction of cannabis.
Which 4?
Kentucky, Colorado, Oregon.
Oh, Oregon, sorry.
New York. And there are a few others, but it's what we call a confusion of the week, as you know. It's Indiana, Wisconsin, Nebraska, and Michigan all within the last month where products are confiscated. Mm. The Attorney General comes out with an opinion. In some cases, depending on the letter of the law or not, public outcry then changes that opinion. But I call it the flavor of the week on CBD confusion, and we're starting to experience that issue well known here in New York.
And one of the reasons why we've gotten this far in New York State is because the Binghamton University's pharmacy school agreed to be the research arm for this work. That's what's given it the legitimacy, and we have a comfort level in New York State moving forward that we're getting some state-of-the-art research being done on New York-produced CBD, cannabidiol. Thanks.
Can I just make one other comment? I do have to run back because we have our conference and we have a session, but I look at this from a lay perspective and legislative as well. All of us develop some, like most of you develop some expertise. You obviously have 2 colleagues of ours in both houses who have a passion and expertise and a real understanding of what this is. I don't have that same level of expertise, and I'm not going to sit here and tell you I do. So I would recommend this. I think looking at these products, and I distinctly remember seeing some of the things that are done by Cornell, a lot of our members just don't know this. They don't. They dance around in 100 different ways. I'm double checking on my way over to be very candid, like, okay, I think I know what hemp is and what its value is, but your diligence in reaching out to your legislators just goes a long way. Because we're generalists, you know, if you get involved in this type of stuff, that's one thing. From a political perspective, I'll say this and either walk out or get thrown out. I had introduced a bill a number of years ago to ban synthetic marijuana, and it engendered quite a bit of a discussion. And even now, as I was coming over, this story today, 16 people got hospitalized because of a bad batch of K2. Mm-hmm. Now, regardless of what one thinks about that type of issue, that creates a story in and of itself. When you say 16 people get sick, well, it's like Legionnaires' knees or something like that. So that has, I think that has an effect on some of the discussion we have here. But I would, again, respectfully say, your diligence in educating legislators, and probably equally as important, our staff, is very important. So on that note, I'm going to just say thank you.
Thank you.
Nice to see all of you.
Thank you, leader.
And DOCA, you may, Henry, also agree that I think we maybe need a bill on synthetic CBD and all synthetic cannabinoids. It could be the takedown of the CBD industry, some issues that we're having with synthetic CBD, where folks are getting sick.
And more important is the focus on creating the laws so people can work in the frames of the natural products. Because you create all these problems by having gray zones, and then people start creating, you know, creative solutions. And at this moment right now, I mean, if you look at the world and also America, nobody can.
We can't produce enough cannabidiol. This is what we're working in my company. Of course, we have other cannabinoids, but now this is the issue. We can't produce enough. We're growing 2,000 acres in our own farms, and the market is exploding. But the problem and the reason we don't have a manufacturing facility in America is because your laws are not harmonized like in Europe. So this is the only thing that's stopping it. I think the moment you get the laws with the federal government and the local governments in place, you don't even need to invest as a government, because there are people ready to mm-hmm. do a lot of things here. So that's the only thing.
Absolutely. Right.
Is hemp universally legal pretty much in Europe?
Well,
or
you have
still
to,
some areas that are closed
off? No, you have to remember that since 1997 in Europe, we have been growing this on a very large scale. So we have the equipment, we have the knowledge, we have the tools to do this on a very large scale. Now in America, we're just starting to do things, but I think if the laws become favorable for investment, I mean, we are ready to build a factory here. So this is the only thing we're waiting for is, as he said, we have to educate, or I don't know how, but we have to change these federal laws. That's the only thing. Mm-hmm. You don't even have to worry about the synthetics, because it will go right. away by itself.
And they are growing. It is regulated. So we're aware, for example, in Canada, they started the program in 98, but it is regulated by the Health Canada's Office of Controlled Substances, as opposed to their Ministry of Agriculture. And similarly, there are different laws in Europe. For example, even the definition of industrial hemp, Switzerland has a 0.2%. So there are differences, but they've not had the arrested development based on total prohibition. They've allowed this regulated crop to grow and become a viable industry there.
Yeah, and I just want to add one thing. The thing you showed with $600 million of revenue, it's European or Canadian hemp coming to America.
Right.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
you should yeah. think mm-hmm. about that.
It's
that's
actually
right.
mostly China, believe it or not. They are the largest exporters to the United States, and we are the largest importers in the world. And that $688 million doesn't include, by the way, that's from SPINS data, doesn't include Costco or Whole Foods. And both of those purveyors are huge purveyors
right.
of hemp products, and they're not even included in that $688 million. So every day, as Senator Wyden from Oregon, who is a tremendous hemp hero working across the aisle with Republicans, Mitch McConnell and Rand Paul say, we are giving away this competition every day. And so we're aware when we talk about the feds versus the feds, it's pretty cut and dry. It's not necessarily factions as it is. We have this beautiful system of government in our country, the legislative branch, the executive branch, and the judicial branch. And the legislative heroes who drafted the Farm Bill and who continue to put protective language into these annual Consolidated Appropriations Act, they know what their intent was with the Farm Bill, which again is just research and has, as my co-panelists have very articulately stated, we need to move it beyond research into full commercialization and an agricultural commodity. But their legislative intent was clear. Any part of the plant Cannabis sativa L, including the extracts, and the executive branch, the DEA, the Drug Enforcement Administration, charged with enforcing and implementing this law, disagrees with that legislative intent. So the Hemp Industries Association, as stakeholders who have successfully sued the DEA twice in the past, just brought before the Ninth Circuit at the judicial branch, please work it out between the legislative branch and the executive branch. And unfortunately, that ruling did not come down very favorably, except to protect on some level as a type of affirmative defense extracts being extracted from hemp produced in farm bill compliant states, which thanks to these heroic legislators and thanks to the governor and the researchers and the Department of Ag is a farm bill compliant booming state, really wanting to see New York succeed here. But we've got issues, as we know, even within New York.
But so what's the reciprocity between those states?
So right now we're still at this ridiculous gray area because the memorandum, we got a decision in this case, which we called the marijuana extract case just 2 weeks ago. They call it a memorandum, as these justices, these three Ninth Circuit justices, as opposed to a decision or an opinion or a ruling, because they don't want it to be precedent setting. They ask for it to be an unpublished opinion. But they're stating basically that this marijuana extract rule, and it takes an hour and a half to explain it to attorneys, so I don't want to get us too in the weeds here, right? But the marijuana extract rule was 5.5 years in the making, from 2011 to 2016 by the DEA. And they defined marijuana extract as one or more cannabinoids extracted from the genus cannabis. They said nothing about above 0.3 or below 0.3. They did nothing to distinguish whether these extracts, these cannabinoids, would be extracted from industrial hemp or from medical or adult use cannabis, otherwise known as marijuana or pot. So we brought them to court and said, hey, you didn't contemplate the Farm Bill back when you proposed this rule in 2011, and the Farm Bill says any part of the plant Cannabis sativa L with less than 0.3. Therefore, we say that cannabinoids, CBD specifically, of course, extracted from hemp should not be a controlled substance. And these justices essentially are saying, well, it is a controlled substance unless you're working under the four corners of the Farm Bill, and even then they're not saying it's okay. They're saying the marijuana extract rule doesn't violate the Farm Bill because the Farm Bill contemplated conflict with the Controlled Substances Act and preempted it by stating these opening words, notwithstanding the Controlled Substances Act. So I've given you a lot of information without giving you any answers, but what I think I'm underscoring here is the tremendous amount of confusion, conflation, and gray area that we're asking people to invest tens of millions of dollars in.
Exactly. All right.
So one thing that I'd like, you know, to point out to you guys, there's three buckets, or Venn diagram. Where's Axel? This morning we were in a group, right, and it's Venn diagram. There's medical marijuana, which is a whole other issue. There's the CBD, and there's the rest of the plant, right? And not all answers are the same
for
all three of those buckets.
Exactly.
So it's very dangerous to group, and a lot of people don't know this. As I talk to people all over the state and the country, they don't realize. The CBD is the hot one right now because it's kind of like a crush, right? But the rest of the plant is money. And we need to be able to grow the money. So we need to keep that in mind, or if you guys don't mind, keeping that in mind as you regulate or legislate or interact with congressional representatives. It's like, let's get some acreage. Let's get some material. CBD, medical marijuana, those are important, but different.
Are there THC issues within the stock itself?
Technically, yeah. Since Larry and Chris and in general, is it, yes, it's all over the plant, but at very, very, to very, very low levels.
There's no concern of that 0.3 level.
No. When you say
it's in one section of the plant, that's where the concentration is for our purposes.
Yeah.
When you say are there THC issues, it's going to be in the plant. It's going to be far below the 0.3%.
Yeah.
And in fact, we had conversations with people in Kentucky last week about how we're testing for THC here, saying that if we're including stock in there, it is bringing our levels down, right? And so the stock has very, very low levels of THC.
And the stock is actually, if I understand the DEA stuff right there, it's actually exempt. I, you know, the stock's not a big deal. But I
they only regulate the seeds.
I can't make the stock without the seeds.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
Just I think probably one fine point there is that after this marijuana extract rule came out and we filed our petition for review with the Ninth Circuit, the DEA immediately came out with a clarification after we filed our petition. And they stated there, so you're aware, okay, it's true, since the HIA won the last time when we took them to court in 2003 and 2004, the THC or the resin which adheres to the surface of the mature stock, this is verbatim from their clarification, or that which adheres to the exterior surface of the seed of cannabis is exempt. So there are zero issues even through their clarification of the marijuana extract rule.
What I think...
Well, I think calling it the marijuana extract rule probably makes the issue even more difficult.
But I think what Mark is saying... What Mark is saying is that there are so many lucrative opportunities if we pursue the nutritional aspects and the fiber and the construction and all of the various things that people are doing. Even though I venture, I don't know, Chris, maybe you said this already, we're issuing a lot of licenses and probably half of them are for CBD, correct? So the stakes are high in terms of us getting this right and protecting that group of people from potential incursions by big pharmaceutical and other interests that
there's no doubt.
Could
biggest
money
is CBD. Checks is the grain.
Right, but I think, but Mark, you said it right. It's the gold rush, right? And
right.
So so Jared Nelson is from SUNY New Paltz, and he's doing research on the fiber. Wave hi. I think that there are a group of us that would say that it really is the fiber that is going to be what brings long-term or longevity and sustainability to this crop. And that requires large infrastructure.
It's sort of the hang-up right now, and the reason why the Hemp Industries Association formed in 1994 was to demonstrate to the DEA that we were not going to divert extracts or cannabinoids into the drug market, and we've been almost strictly an oilseed and fiber organization. That's where the trillion-dollar industries are. We have absolutely, over time, evolved as a board, as an organization, and through an executive director to embrace cannabinoids, and in fact, take the DEA to task and call them to the carpet in court over hemp's ability to use them. But it's very important to note that hemp is the longest, strongest fiber in the world. And while we love that after it is harvested and processed, it's a lot of money and expense to harvest and process it. And so the reason why we see this huge rush in cannabidiol and in hemp extracts, yeah. A, their efficacy, we are a sick world suffering from all manner of conditions and opioid addictions and everything else, but it's a much lower cost infrastructure to develop that industry, yeah. And we need to nurture it because it's actually helping generate the revenue for the much more expensive infrastructure for oilseed and fiber.
Exactly.
I think it's very important always to look at the whole plant and never take the discussion of separate parts. Because you can call it a gold rush, but I'll say it's rational that you can, from one hectare, get medicine, food, and the clothing. I mean, why should you restrict one and another? So I think we should always just talk about the plan.
Absolutely.
Yeah, the other best thing people can do is get familiar with the products this can go into. The supply chain, selling in the supply chain, like the fibers used in insulating panels in cars. Imagine we're kicking out Fords with insulating panels made of hemp. I mean, that there's some big money, right? And it's happening in Europe. That's what they use it for in Europe. You know?
I think when we haven't sort of gone down the laundry list, and I won't exhaust it, but when we talk about the 25,000 products, important for folks to realize, hemp is not just high in protein, it's the highest digestible form of protein in the entire planet animal kingdom, based on its unique amino acid profile, the fact that it has no trypsin inhibitors, which prevent us from absorbing protein. But we move on from human and animal nutrition to body care to general wellness, then into paper, textiles, building materials, biocomposites, industrial sealants and coatings, nanotechnology, biomedical applications. Hemp is really here to serve all of humanity's needs, and we're talking about an industrial revolution of truly epic proportions once we can get up to scale and get this infrastructure funded.
Can you,
not that big a deal.
Of the 25,000 uses of hemp, is one I've been contemplating for a while and haven't gotten an answer with our plastic grocery bag issues. Is there a hemp alternative for a single-use plastic grocery bag?
There will be. We'll get there. It's the same thing with the hemp water bottle. And there was a big website, hempwaterbottle.com, and everyone was like, oh, I want, but it hasn't been invented yet. They haven't figured out how to invent it. We will get there. We will absolutely get there, Senator.
Yeah. Yeah, not yet.
Anything we haven't touched on yet, and we're not out of time yet, but if there's issues that anybody on the panel would like to talk about,
or questions from the
or
group,
questions from, we've got the group here. It's not meant to be exclusive of you sitting out there listening. Sure.
Just a comment. I like the plastic bag idea, but I think the trouble is looking at it as plastic. Hemp bags exist. You just take one to the store and put your groceries in it.
Yeah, there's that. The reusable,
they're not on the expense scale the same as far as the cost of the bag.
No, she means to bring it with you.
No, I know. Bring it back. Yes, I know those exist. I know, but on a scale that's cheap enough to
throw out. Yeah.
It's going to be tough to blow a bag.
Yeah.
Dissolve hemp. It's going to be tough. I'm a chemical engineer. It's pretty easy to do polymers, blow it into bags. Right. Pretty
simple. Yeah. So that doesn't solve our problem then. In that.
Right. Sorry.
I didn't mean to throw everybody off course with that, but there's something I've been thinking about.
One thing it can't do.
But batteries, now we're talking.
Yeah. Yes.
I would just love to say that the reason why we had the Hemp for Victory campaign that Chris Smart mentioned here during World War II is because Japan deliberately and quite effectively crippled the U.S. Navy by invading Manila and crippling our source of industrial hemp, which all of the, you know, the uniforms, the sails, the parachutes that saved George Bush Sr., all of those were made from hemp and traditionally made for hemp for hundreds of years. In fact, in 1812, Napoleon successfully invaded Russia in an effort to cripple the English Navy and to cripple their access of industrial hemp, which had been used, of course, for their Navy as well. And most developed countries have not actually produced and processed their own country's demand, even throughout history, for industrial hemp and had to depend on export. So our history here is, in the United States, is very rich. Our first cannabis law was in 1619, ordering farmers to make trial of the Indian hemp seed, and in fact, in 1763 to 1767 in the Jamestown colonies, it was unlawful for farmers not to produce hemp during times of shortage. So from Hempstead, Long Island, it's not for nothing, guys.
So now it's a matter of national security, too. That's another argument
Hempstead.
We have. Yeah.
Okay. Hempstead?
I was going to actually ask Jeff Williams, what does the Farm Bureau think about this?
We're fully supportive. I mean, as you know, farmers will grow anything as long as they can make money off it.
Well, and there's a market, right?
There's a market. And that was my question about the federal bill, is that it is truly the chicken and the egg. Is, you know, the farms that have engaged in the Ag Americas program are early adopters. And there's a hundred of them, which is a lot of people. But to get to the mass commercialization and mass adoption is going to take the change in the federal law. But I mean, they're there, absolutely. I think you just need to have that peer-to-peer conversations and so they can see the viability economically of doing it, because obviously it all comes down to money. I actually had a question about the trial. You mentioned that pesticides aren't needed because they can't appear early and crowd out weeds. Did you have any bug or insect issues?
So I don't know. It's not that pesticides necessarily aren't needed. There are no pesticides available.
Right.
those are two different. And yes, there are absolutely word disease issues. White mold, which attacks 400 different crop species, I work with it in vegetables all the time, is a problem in hemp. And to my knowledge, there's no resistance to that pathogen in any of the hemp germplasm, although it would be really interesting to look at a broad source of hemp germplasm to identify resistance. There's also root rot issues, especially when those plants are little. You know, getting them germinated and up to that maybe 2 or 3 inches. Once they hit 2 or 3 inches, they tend to take off really well.
But, you know, if the ground is too, they're kind of fussy, it seems. You know, if the ground is too wet, if it, you know, if it gets too hard on the top, they can't break through. And so those are some of the things we're going to be looking for as you know, we try to develop cultivars for the state. There are also no organically approved pesticides. There's no federal registration.
Okay, that was my next
there
question.
Is no federal registration because federally it's right. illegal, right? And so there is no federal registration, which means there can be no state registration. And so that's a very tricky thing.
Did you think of three or four products off the top of your head that obviously aren't labeled for use now, but you could use on hemp?
Yes. I can think of three or four without a
question.
Yeah, no, absolutely. You know, because in our snap bean production, we have products that are used both in organic systems and conventional systems to work against white mold. Those products are not labeled for hemp. It's illegal to use them in the state of New York. So our hands are tied, and you know that could be an issue.
Yes, sir.
If I might make a suggestion on that point, the same is true for the material cultivated for the medical marijuana program, mm-hmm. except the health department works with DEC, and they approve pesticides for use. And I don't see why the industry association and the academic interest, the research interest, couldn't approach DEC and work out a similar structure for them.
Right.
State marijuana programs doing that all over.
Yeah.
Washington, the state of Washington, not so into their hemp program, but they love their marijuana program, and having reaped $1.4 billion in tax revenue last year from it. But they've got some approved pesticides.
Yes, they publish lists. New York won't publish a list, but Oregon, Oregon, Washington, and Colorado publish lists. Mm-hmm.
Senator, a question about soil conditions. What have we learned so far about the proper soil needs to be effective in growth? Early on, we talked that maybe they would grow anywhere. Is that true?
No.
I'm so sorry. I screamed that from the rooftops in the 90s. It was not true.
It wants your best ground.
It loves following alfalfa.
It really wants your best ground. Well-drained soils, it's a high nutrient demander. This is not a crop that's going to become your next big weed problem. The seeds are babies.
Scratched off my talking points then.
And also, I think it's really important to know that they don't outcompete weed species if they germinate at the same time.
Right.
So that was a huge piece of our work, our observations from last year, was that if the hemp grows first and canopies out, then it can shade out weed species. But if they germinate at the same time, it doesn't compete at all.
So we need Roundup Ready hemp.
Yeah. Well, except that Roundup doesn't work anymore.
Jen does an amazing job when she presents to discuss. When we say high nutrient, we don't want to really gloss that over. And you often state the statistic, Jen, that in Canada, where there are still very much researching, and mostly for grain, due to infrastructure costs, they've made themselves the world leader in hemp food processing and production. But they're at 200 pounds per acre right now and haven't hit maximum yield of nitrogen. So we also have a duty here so that hemp doesn't go the same old, we're gonna salinate the soil and ruin it. We also need to be introducing regenerative agricultural techniques. When we look at that, it is a high management, high demand, but a high return crop.
Yes, sir.
Senator, Stephen Wood with the Research Foundation for SUNY. My work involves supporting SUNY researchers and attempting to commercialize their innovations, and very grateful for the support provided by the state to further that research. I understand, as Joy said earlier, there was $10 million, $5 million for research, and $5 million for processing equipment. And I understand that a good portion of that has come out, at least on the research side. I don't see anyone from ESD here, but does anyone have a pulse on where those funds are in terms of status, what has been allocated, what remains, and what may be forthcoming?
On the research side?
Sure.
I think a bulk of the research went to Cornell and Morrisville. Yeah. My understanding is there may be $1.5 million of that left.
Okay.
And so some, I have forwarded some grant applications to ESD on behalf of a number of New Paltz and some others that were didn't get into the Farm Viability Institute round. So that's all I can tell you on that, but I don't think the last portion has been allocated yet.
But on the other physical side, you have a project in your district, right?
On the processing side?
Processing side. Southern Tier Hemp is one that was awarded mm-hmm. through the regional council process. There's one I'm aware of. I know there's, I think that's there's been others.
Southern Tier Hemp is a regional CBD processor.
Yeah. Yeah, so how much of that has been allocated yet? I don't know off the top of my head.
Okay. And that was a 50-50 match with the private organization bringing 50% to the
I believe so.
Well, they usually, is it 50-50 or is it usually?
Well, he's talking about the processing
20%?
Grants.
Yeah,
the processing grants was 50-50. Okay. Southern Tier Hemp received money from the regional council round, the economic round, yeah. So that was an 80-20. It was a different a different funding.
Yeah, the regional councils try to make it 80-20.
So
it was 80 private to 20 public, yeah.
But it was a large, much larger scale project than the processing grants that are available through that funding stream. I think it was 500,000.
That was 50-50.
Correct.
10,000 to $500,000. Right. Awards that they were up to.
Yeah.
We can get figures for you, try to get an update as far as where the state is on both the research mm-hmm. side and the processing yeah. side for figures. If that's
okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. So those were range from 10,000 to 500,000 grants, is that what you said?
For processing.
For processing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it was a 50-50 match.
Yeah. Southern Tier is a much larger project, so it went through different funding mechanism.
Hi, I was licensed to grow and process, and we actually applied for those grants. Our projects are both over $1 million, and we received word back that because we're a startup, we actually don't qualify for any of these grants, which seems to be self-defeating since this is the first year that hemp is allowed to be processed in New York State. So we submitted 2 30-page applications that we worked 4 months on, and immediately we were voided because they considered us to be a startup. So I just wanted to have some clarification because I saw Southern Tier receive $650,000, and this would be their first year too in New York State, so that would make them a startup as well.
I can't speak directly in regards to the processing. We partner with them. It's ESD program, but I can give me your contact information. We can discuss with them, but that's actually funded in by ESD. We do consult with them, but we can try to make it
Yeah, I'm not familiar with that either. I'd be happy to look into it as well with them. But
Southern Tier Hemp isn't, to correct one thing, isn't considered a startup because it really is an affiliate of a Kentucky-based company. But this does sound counterintuitive that startups would not be eligible on the face of it. We're trying to start up the industry.
Yeah.
So maybe we could get him some clarification. I'd appreciate it.
We're located in Berlin. So we're doing 30-acre grow right now. We've actually constructed a 15,000 square foot greenhouse. We have 60,000 plants germinated as we speak. We're constructing our lab as we speak as well. We've partnered up with Farm On and a few other farms. We're doing about 100 acres in our co-op. We're trying to connect with also other farmers, but in New York State, but New York's not releasing the information on other farmers, so there's no way for us to get into communication with them except for attending events like this. Other states, I actually cold-called about 700 farmers throughout the entire U.S. because these other states that are involved will actually release the information and give you everybody that's farming. New York State, on the other hand, has only allowed us to have the surrounding counties due to the issue of cross-pollination.
Mm-hmm.
But it'd be very helpful since we are doing, we're going to be processing for using CO2 extraction to help out other farmers, because ultimately these farmers need a place to put their flower, and New York State doesn't have the infrastructure yet. And so we're one of 7 that I'm aware of that are licensed for CBD extraction, but there's no way to communicate with other farmers.
Are you involved with the Hemp Industries Association?
I'm not.
Okay.
I would love to meet
you. This, she's your best advocate on this topic right now.
Jeff, is there some limitation at Ag and Markets of not disclosing who's growing?
Yeah.
I'm not aware. I mean, I could have to double check that with our council.
Yeah, they've been, they are operating out of an abundant sense of safety. They are reluctant to put that information out there, figuring people who may not be aware that there's no recreational value to this crop will come and be disruptive to, even though there's signs outside all of the fields that say none of these plants contain THC. Nonetheless, that's been the issue, but it's something we're having conversations with them about because of the cross-pollination issue. People need to know what's growing where before they plant something and wind up jeopardizing their neighbor's crops.
I do want to mention that the New York State's first professional conference dedicated exclusively to industrial hemp, if you're looking to get into those markets, is taking place here at the Albany Capital Center on June 4th and 5th. We have both Assemblywoman Lopardo and Senator O'Mara will be visiting us there. But if you're interested in learning more and networking, because networking is where it's at, grassroots activism is where my career started, and it's still the most important thing I do today. And so networking at these events is pretty important. And that's the Eastern U.S. Hemp Growers Conference, and it's easternushemp.com.
Next week?
June 4th and 5th. So not next week, but the week after. Mm-hmm.
Anything else?
Okay.
Does anybody have anything else? This is a very quiet bunch today.
So
must be the weather.
So we appreciate, absolutely appreciate the $5 million, no doubt.
And the wall.
But to get bigger, what's next? I really don't want more millions, right? Because the industry has to self-generate sustainability,
true.
Right? So I'm not looking for, we'll just do 10 million. But what is you guys' vision as to what's next to get this to a $1 billion industry? Because that's what I want.
Well, I think clearing up these federal confusion and limitations we have is the number one problem right now.
Is there some action we can take out of this meeting? I mean, could you call together a meeting like this and put the congressional staffers in that audience so they hear the concerns from us who are concerned about the, I mean, that would be great.
Yeah. It's something to
you invite me on top.
All right, let us think about how we can do that and how responsive they'll be to attending something like that. It's not always easy to get down there in D.C. a lot,
but
they're in D.C. a lot more than we're in Albany. So,
but they'll listen to you faster than they'll listen to me.
And I do have conversations with my own and with others.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll continue with that.
Yep.
Now, Donna said they're going to hopefully maybe be doing a resolution at the Assembly.
Mm-hmm.
I think we unfortunately have some kind of rule in the Senate that we don't do resolutions urging Congress
Correct.
To act.
Right.
I know we've tried to get them before on other issues, and it hasn't worked. But doesn't mean we can't get together and write joint letters.
They just might not be aware of the issues to build a $1 billion industry. I mean, maybe they have heard about it, but they haven't sat here and go, didn't think of that. I need the seeds to make the stuff.
We'll work on
that.
All right.
One last comment here.
Just a question on THC and the hemp. Since we're going to be extracting CBD oil from the hemp, there's going to be an exponentially large amount of THC that we produce. So removing other parts of the plant, so the THC is going to rise. We can isolate that THC out, but New York State hasn't done anything yet in terms of where we should be disposing of the THC. So, I mean, we're going to have about 50 kilograms to 200 kilograms of just THC, and we don't know what to do with it yet.
Your CBD research partner agreement addresses that mildly by saying you're going to appropriately dispose
right.
of that. And by the way, we like to la-la-la-la-la on all this THC that's happening in those facilities. I would, Chris, left, but maybe Jeff, would you suggest that he contact Kate Close or Annalise in terms of what they would, just so you know you're in compliance. Again, that CBD Research Partner Agreement is very vague on it, but it puts the onus on you to destroy those so that they're rendered unusable, but I think it would probably be in your best interest to get sort of an email or in writing the methods that they would suggest for that.
Great.
Okay. Well, thank you all very much. It's been helpful for me. I hope it's been helpful for you. And we will do what we can to keep the pressure on Congress.
That's right.
To get them to act. And if there's a way to have some kind of joint state-federal conference or a meeting like this on that, I'd be happy to help organize that.
That's good. Thanks for helping me with this.
Thank you both.
Thanks, everybody.